Second thing, I'm going to add insult to injury, because I'm going to talk about, title is categories like Hilbert spaces. So I'm not going to talk about groupoids. I'm going to talk about categories. I'm not going to talk about C-star algebras. I'm going to talk about Hilbert spaces. Actually, Mark asked me to talk about a different topic that would have fit much better with groupoids and C-star algebra, but this is more recent work and I find it much more exciting, and I decided to go for the adventurous talk. So categories like Hilbert spaces, as it's like fruit flies like a banana. I'm going to try and convince you that, first of all, we're going to talk about categories that resemble the category of Hilbert spaces. But secondly, I'm going to try and convince you that you might think category theory is all algebraic and all sort of abstract and there's no analysis anywhere. But actually, the two do like each other. They go well together in some sense. That's the goal of the talk. Before I go any further, I should say that this is a joint work with Andre Cornell. I'll use a paper by Rui Barbosa. Nesta van der Scha and Matt Di Meglio, who is in the audience today. And it's based on two papers, not a very recent one, the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences in 22. I think it's 23. No, and the other one is in Advances in Maths 23. So what's this about? As we heard in Aiden's talk, any C-star algebra always embeds into the bounded operators on some Hilbert space. Same kind of way, we can talk about C-star categories, which is a notion due to Guess, Lima, and Roberts. Sort of like a C-star algebra with many objects, a typed version of it, if you like. Still something like a norm on all the arrows, or on the elements, if you like, and there's still something like a star. And each of these things, the first thing they prove, doesn't embed into a B of H, but embeds into the big category of all Hilbert spaces. So by which I mean, this is a category. Objects are Hilbert spaces. Maps are bounded linear maps. So if you fix on one specific object H, all the endomaps on that will be that algebra. So all these algebras sit inside there. So in some sense, the whole study of C-star algebra and C-star categories is, you want to study subcategories of this one.
Sorry, Chris, do all C-star categories embed into the category of Hilbert spaces or the category of bounded operators on?
Yes, let me make that clear. Take a color, maybe. So by Hilb, I mean objects are Hilbert spaces. And just for the sake to be concrete, let's say complex and not real. And the arrows are all bounded linear maps. Make sense, everyone?
Yeah. Will you define what a C-star category is?
I wasn't going to, but I can say it in words. It's a category that's enriched in Banach spaces. So every set of arrows from one object to the other is a Banach space. You can add stuff, it has a norm. The composition respects addition and norm. There's a star in the sense that whenever you have a map from one object to another, the star goes the other way. And if you do it twice, nothing happens. And it satisfies a C-star property, in the sense that the norm of F star F is the same as the norm of F squared. And that's it. So it's really just a multi-object version of a C-star algebra. Here's another question. Or just nodding along, great. Okay, so the question I want to talk about today is, when I give you an arbitrary category, when is category C, when is it that one? When is it equivalent as a category to that one? I'm going to give you an answer. Depending on time, get back to Elizabeth's question, we might have a variation where we don't talk about bounded linear maps, but maybe contractions, contractive linear maps. And depending on time, I might have a variation where we talk not about Hilbert spaces, but about Hilbert modules. We'll see how we go. And the answer I'm going to give you is a purely categorical one. So there's not going to be any mention of complex numbers or norms or anything. It's all going to be algebra, composition, multiplication, nothing else. So that's the plan. So the first thing I'm going to shoot for, theorem one, says if a category C satisfies six axioms that I'll walk you through, then this happens. Just to be precise again, I'm going to talk only about what's called locally small categories. Small means the set of objects is a set. Locally small is slightly more permissive in the sense that whenever you fix two objects, you look at all the arrows in between that, that's a set. It can still be a class, many objects, but at least locally it's small. But I'm going to totally ignore all the size issues from now on. All right. So now my next job is, what are these six axioms? I'm going to go through them one by one. Axiom one, we just talked about. I want that to be something like an involution, like a star of C star algebra, C star category. This time it's going to be a functor contravariant. And I want it to be the identity on objects. So that means if I have a map from some object H to some object K, then there should also be a map in the other direction, such that if you do it twice, nothing happened. And it's a functor, which means the star of the identity on some object is just the identity on that object. And if I compose two things and take their star, it's the same as first taking the stars and right. That's it. It's the first axiom. I want there to exist a star on my category. And the star is so important, all the other axioms are I'm gonna insist that they respect the star. If you have any category with a star, you can talk about things like isometries. So F is an isometry. By definition, for me, just means F star F is the identity on its domain. And similarly, you can talk about unitaries. If this, and also the other ones, just as you would in a C-star algebra. Are you happy with that? That's axiom one. And let's move to, go ahead. That will follow from the theorem, in fact.
Sorry, could you repeat what the question was?
Is the star, do we ask that it's unique?
Okay.
Yep. The answer is no. I'm just going to ask that some such thing exists. And then from the theorem, it will follow that it is actually the only one, because I didn't tell you, but this equivalence here is going to respect all the structure I ask for. So it's the one corresponding to adjoint of linear maps. Maybe the other thing to say is if you're in the actual category of Hilbert spaces, if C is Hilb, then of course such a thing exists. Taking adjoints. All right, second one, I'm going to ask that tensor products exist. And I say tensor, but I really just mean what's called monoidal structure. So that means some way, if you give me two objects, I can put them together. You give me H and K, there's a new object called H tensor K. Same for morphisms. If I have two maps, F and G of the right type, you can put them together in a map, a new map called F tensor G that have the composite type. And part of that is that this is associative in the sense that if I have three objects, I put them together, bracketed to the left. That should be isomorphic and in fact, unitarily isomorphic to doing it the other way. Makes sense.
Do you fix a particular choice of associator or just ask that one such one exists?
Here I'm gonna fix one, yes. But there's general theorems about monoidal categories that say it doesn't really, really matter. I will ask also that these associators satisfy all the usual coherence things, but I'm going to suppress them. So this is like a binary way of putting two things together. I want it to be a nullary way, be something like an empty system, such that if I censor it with arbitrary thing. That's unitarily ISO to the thing itself and the same on the right. Something like a unit for the tensor cross. So actual Hilbert spaces, of course, have this, where this would be the complex numbers, like the one-dimensional space. So I ask that the tensors exist, and I'm going to ask two special properties of my unit here. One is I'm going to ask that it's what's called a separator, which means I can tell two maps apart by testing them on maps from the unit. So I have two parallel maps, let's say F and G. And are they equal? Let me see where I can fit this. As soon as for all things into H, all things into K, let's say little k, these two maps are the same. Am I doing H tensor? And this should be an H unit. Doing? I want F and G here. Sorry, that's what I want.
I'm getting myself confused. I shouldn't do.
This should be an L. So this is saying, think about the category Hilbert spaces. This is the one-dimensional space. Linear map from that to H is just a vector in H, really. So it's saying two maps out of a tensor product are equal as soon as they're equal on all pure tensor elements. So that's saying I is good enough to detect differences between maps. And the other thing I'm going to ask is that I is simple in the sense that there is no subspaces of it.
How did I write that?
So as soon as I have an injection, or in category speak, a monomorphism into I, little s maybe, there's only two of those. Either s is a unitary, or s is zero. I haven't told you what zero means. We'll do that in the next axiom. But basically, I'm just saying up to unitary isomorphism, there's only two such things. Again, if this is the one-dimensional space, then the subspace of it has to be zero or one-dimensional.
Okay. I think you're right. The first one, the A, not applied to K, not to H.
Okay, thanks. I got myself confused.
We meant unitary. You can have like scalars, like
I meant ISO. Thanks.
I might have missed this, but is the tensor product of two objects
weak? In what sense?
Might there be two different objects satisfying this life?
Oh, no, that's good. So the tensor itself is just like this from C up to C. This is a functor from C times C to C. So when you give me two objects, there's a function that determines the tensor product. There's no choice. All right, that's the second axiom. Third one is something like direct sums. I want something like direct sums to exist, except I'll talk about, you know, elements of objects. We can't sort of peek inside the objects. All you're given is this mystery bag of things and how they compose. So they're called byproducts, and I have to describe the direct sums by their compositional behavior. So again, just like here, there's like a nullary version and a binary version. I'm going to have a nullary and a binary version for this. The nullary version is I want that to be a zero object, which means I want it to be a special object that I'll write zero, such that for any other object H, there's a unique map going to zero. Of course, you should think about this as the zero dimensional Hilbert space. And of course, any linear map, any map whatsoever into here is there's only one. Because of the star, that also means there's a unique map to any other space. If you compose the two, that means for any two objects, there's something that we'll call the zero map. Because again, in the category over spaces, what does this thing do? It sends every vector to the zero vector. There's a nullary version. The binary version. Says when you have two objects H and K, I want that to exist a third one. I'll write H plus K. And I want that to exist two injections. Let me write I and J maybe. Now, first of all, I want these to be to form what's called a co-product, in the sense that if there's any other way of putting H and K together, it has to factor through this. To this actual universal one. That's a usual property direct sums have, right? Maps here are completely determined by maps out of the two summons. But moreover, I want the two summons to be orthogonal. I want to respect the star. So that means if I take the star of one of these injections, I go from H to the direct sum, I project out into K again, that should be zero. This zero map here. Direct sums in the category Hilbert spaces will satisfy this.
You mentioned that you want H and K to both embed into H by product K. So is the fact that these are monomorphisms not automatic from the structure?
I'm not certain enough to put my hand on the fire and say so now, yes, but no, I'm going to avoid answering.
Okay. Fair.
So part of the definition is that these two are isometries. So I want this. Thanks.
Probably specify that. Don't think it follows from the rest that I've said.
Okay, so these are called star byproducts. Right, that's number three. Then let's move to number four. That will fit here. Number four is going to say something about equalizers, and people that know categories will know that as soon as you have products are kind of limits, the other kind of limits are called equalizers. Again, I'm going to insist that they cooperate with the star. What's an equalizer? Whenever you have two maps parallel, an equalizer of this is something that equalizes them in the sense that first this and that same as first this and that. And it's the universal such thing. If there's any other pretender that sort of wants to be the equalizer that does this and then that, then it has to go through the universal thing. So just this is called equalizer. I ask that for every two parallel F and G, there exists this E. The star means that I want this E to be an isometry again. So this. I want this diagram to be not just E does the universal factoring thing, but the E and then E star is the same as doing that. Again, the category Hilbert spaces has this, because if you give me two maps, I can look at the subspace of vectors where F and G do the same thing. Of course, it will do that. It's the largest such thing, and the inclusion is an isometry. Good, getting there. Five. So here we talked about zero maps.
Here we talked about
equalizer of two arbitrary maps. Equalizer of arbitrary two maps exist. I'm sort of going to ask the converse of this one, but not for any alt maps, but for where one of them is the zero map. So specific, if I put G to be zero here, then an equalizer is just a kernel of F. So here we said that every F has a kernel and it's an isometry. Now I'm going to ask that every isometry is a kernel of something. So if I have an isometry, let's say F, sense that this. I have an isometry, I want there to exist some object K. There's always this zero map, always exists. I want there to be some other map G such that F is the kernel of G, which means, first of all, F at zero is the same as FG. And if there's some other thing that thinks it wants to be the kernel of G, really it goes through to F. So in other words, for all isometries, symmetry F, is a G such that F is kernel G. This is true in the category Hilbert spaces. Why? If you give me an isometry, then I can write H as, and let's just pretend it's an inclusion, look at its image. I can write H as N direct sum and orthogonal and complement. I can project out from there to the complement. The kernel of this, of course, is going to be the inclusion of N. So I write this, I guess. Good. So that's called star kernels, I guess. And the last one. So far, everything I've said is very finitely, right? We put two objects together and hence finitely many ones. We've talked about equalizer of two maps, etc. There's no infinite anywhere yet. The sixth one is going to do that. I'm going to ask that. I'll first write it down and then explain it. That there exist directed colimits of isometries. What does that mean? First of all, I'm going to restrict to isometries. So you give me the mystery category. I keep the same object, but I throw out all the arrows that are not isometries. You just keep the isometries. And then I want that subcategory to have directed colimits, which means if you have a directed diagram, something like this, there's an H1, H2, and H3, et cetera. So that can always go bigger. And isometries between them. Then I want this thing to have a colimit. So again, just like these universal properties, some big H, which they all embed. That's the colimit. You write it down maybe. And the universal property says if there's any other thing that also thinks it wants to be the directed colimit, then it has to factor through the real ones. So in the category of Hilbert spaces, think about some Hilbert space, which is a closed subspace of some bigger one, which is a closed subspace of some even bigger one, et cetera, et cetera. And can you build this big thing? Well, yes, of course you can. You just take the union span. You don't even need to expand the closure of the union. We'll have a unique inner product on it. It'll be a vector space, but we find Hilbert space. It's the smallest one into which they all sit inside as a closed subspace. Okay, and that's it.
Just a question. In terms of action one, 3, 4, and 5 implies in your category to be, to exist also products, co-equalizers,
yes,
and co-kernels, isn't it? Yeah. So it's like a sort of a billing category with that is monoidal.
Sorry, what was the last thing?
Monoidal means that you have this product.
So this is sometimes called monoidal category. But yes, the observation is that once you have a star, the category is self-dual. It's automatically an equivalence of C op and C. So maybe not so much this one, but let's say this one. If you have kernels, and if you take the star of everything, take the kernel and do the star again, you automatically also have co-kernels. Have products, you automatically also have co-products. Right?
Are you asking that these constructions are natural in some sense, or is that not part of the the products?
Yes. So for here, I didn't tell you, but I want these to be unitary and natural, these iso, these associators, and these unitors.
if you had an H prime and a K prime and an L prime.
Yes. With respect to composition, if you like. And the other thing I didn't tell you is I want them to be coherent, which means I have four objects and I sort of reassociate them, sort of all bracketed all the way to the left to all the way to the right. There's two ways of doing that. I want these two ways to be equal. It's a lot of bookkeeping, but it's a very standard definition of an idle category. And there's a nice theorem, coherence theorem, that says once you have these simple ways, for example, the four-way re-bracketing, then any diagram whatsoever you write down from these things, and composition and identities and tensoring, will always commute. So in some sense, that all of that bookkeeping doesn't matter. Right, everybody happy? All right, then, let me try to tell you a bit about the proof before we move to another topic. The plan of the proof is this. You'll notice I've never ever talked about complex numbers or convexity or norms or anything analytic. So my first job is going to be to show that there is some sort of numbers after all, some sort of scalar field we have to reconstruct from these things. Second thing I'm going to do is you give me an arbitrary object H in the mystery category. I'm going to look at all the vectors of H, all the maps from I into H. Whether that's a vector space. And in fact, I'm going to show that that's what's called an orthomodular space. We'll get to the definition later, but it sort of says it has an inner property. It behaves a lot like a Hilbert space, but maybe it isn't quite. Why am I interested in that? Because there's something called Soler's theorem that says under certain conditions, if you have one of these things that's almost a Hilbert space, but maybe not quite, it is actually a Hilbert space. What's the condition? I need there to exist infinite orthogonal sets. Infinite subsets. And to prove that this is an orthomodular space, I'm going to need to talk about certain subspaces that we'll call closed. Again, I'll define what that means. So we need to talk about closed subspaces of that vector space. And the way we're going to get at that is show that there's two other ways of talking about this. One of them is I can talk about the projections on H. Object H inside the category. So by this I mean a map from H to H, P that's equal to P star P. Just as you would in the Sister algebra. And a third way of talking about these things is I can talk about isometries or kernels. Isometries in H. And these three things, you can go up and down between them. The point is, these two are about like internal to the category, if you like. There's actual maps in the category, and this one too. This is something external. Right? We're talking about this set of all maps. We think about them as a vector space, and we then think about them subsets of that. Okay, so that's the sketch. I'm going to treat this as a black box. I'm mostly going to concentrate on these bits so you can see how all the algebraic categorical stuff plays a role. And depending on how we control the time, I might at the end say something about you can circumvent this in a more structured way. But for now, let's just buy it. All right, let's start here. So you give me the mystery category satisfying the axioms. How do I reconstruct the numbers, the scalars? And the idea is I'm going to say a map from I to I. I'm just going to call a scalar. Now, of course, I can compose maps I to I. There's a multiplication on them. They have a unit, the identity on I. So straight away, it's a monoid. I can multiply scalars. Um, And in fact, because of the tensor product axiom, we show that this multiplication has to be commutative. This is sometimes called the Ekman-Hilton argument. And the idea is that I is unitarily isomorphic to two copies of I. So we do a couple of things now. We can do Z on the one factor and W on the other, if Z and W are two scalars. That's the same as doing W first, then Z, or doing it the other way around, Z first. And that's basically the proof that this scalar multiplication is commutative. That's nice. They also have addition.
So for that diagram, in for one of the ways, do you want to actually swap the order of Z and W? Put Z in the second corner and W in the first.
No, I don't. Okay. I want to do them in parallel because they're, you know, because they're parallel, it doesn't matter sort of which one I do first. Okay. Okay, I can also add scalars. How do I do that? You give me two scalars Z and W. I have to produce a new one. We'll call Z plus W. We're sort of going to do the same trick that we did with tensor for composition, but now I'm going to use the direct sums. So the diagonal map into I plus I. Then I do Z on the one summand and W on the other, and then I do the code diagonal again. As you would expect, again, this is commutative. Again, there's a unit, namely like the zero map. And you can prove that the composition distributes over the plus. So it's a semi-ring. And throughout all of that, we had the where did it go? The star. So it's not just a ring, not just a semi-ring, it's a star semi-ring. That's good. And it's not just a star semi-ring, I'm claiming it's a star field. I'll tell you how to divide and how to subtract. I'll divide first. If you give me a scalar Z, it turns out if you use the axiom about kernels, this one, you can factor any map into something, and then an isometry. Isometry is exactly the kernel of the co-kernel of the map. And we talked before about if you have kernels and a star, then you also have co-kernels. So this is sort of like the image you've set. You like? Because we're going from I to I, you can prove that this thing is epic or dense image. Okay. All right, so you give me a scalar. I factor it like this. Now this thing here is an isometry into I, and I was simple. So there's only two cases. Either that thing is invertible or it's zero. So let's call this a K maybe. So either K is zero or K is I. So if K is zero, then this map factors through the zero object. So certainly the whole map factors through the zero object. So Z is zero, and we're good. We don't need to divide by zero. P is iso, that means the whole map is epic, is an epimorphism. So its star is going to be a monomorphism again into I. Again, I is simple. That's what I'm going to say, said epic. Star is zero, one, so. Again, in both cases, we're good because if Z star is ISO, then Z is, sorry, if Z star is zero, then Z is zero. If Z star is ISO, then Z is ISO. So in all the cases, any scalar you give me is either zero or it's invertible. I can divide by non-zero scalars. And then finally, I should tell you how to subtract. And that follows from the semi-ring being not zero sum free. Means that the sum of two things is zero,
then two things must have been zero. This is not the case here, because that gives you a contradiction with this diagonal map here. So it's little proof that I'm brushing under the rug now. Good, so we have an actual field. Check. Now let's look at this thing that I claim to be a vector space. So this is all the vectors, if you like, of the object H, all the maps from I to H. Same kind of trick, I can add them. It's not important that this is an I here, could have been an H. Same kind of trick as here, I can multiply them with a scalar by I tack on tensor factor, I do the scalar on that, and then I forget about the tensor factor. And it does all the axioms of vector spaces, just you check them out correctly, and it's good.
A quick question.
Yeah.
Does it follow from the proofs that this has to be the complex numbers, or can it?
It will eventually. So Soler's theorem says whenever you have an orthomodular space with an infinite orthogonal set over some star field, then the scalars have to be either the reals or the complex or the quaternions. And the space is actually open space. An object of the cascade open spaces. We know straight away, we proved already that our thing is commutative, so this can't happen. I was lying here slightly when I stated the theorem. There's really two things here. The statement is if a mystery thing satisfies 1 to 6, then either C is equivalent to the category of real Hilbert spaces, or it's equivalent to the category of complex ones. You could add another axiom that distinguishes between the two, but let's not. Where was I going to go? Right, we've done this. Let's go. I want to go. Let's do this relatively quickly. Because here we talked about this factorization trick here, right? What is this correspondence here? If you give me an isometry into H, let's say S, I can make a projection out of it on H by just sending it to S star. Just like usual. And vice versa, if you have a projection on H, doing this, where do you send it? Which isometry do you take? Well, you factor the thing as before into the kernel of its co-kernel and something else, and its dagger, in fact. Send it to the kernel of the co-kernel, sort of the inclusion of its image, if you like. And turns out this is a bijection, and it respects the order that I didn't talk about, but you can guess on projections and isometries. Right, what's the third thing in this triangle? So now we have this vector space. What does it mean to be a closed subspace? Let me start the board. So whenever you have a subspace of this vector. So first of all, I should say this is not just a vector space, it has an inner product on it. Because we don't yet know that the scalars are those accomplices, I can't say inner product, I have to say emission form. Give me two vectors, what's their inner product? I'm just going to define it to be F star G. F is a map from I to H. Is map from I to h. So if I first do g, I go from I to h. I do the star of f, I go back to I. This is the thing from I to I. It's something in our base field. Right. Now I can say if I have a subspace of that vector space with emission form, I'm going to say it's closed exactly when I can talk about the orthocomplement in the usual way when you have an inner product. Is equal to its own double orthocomplement. So closed, not in any topological sense, but this sort of algebraic way. Right. So now we can go back to the triangle. We know what closed means. If you give me a projection,
How do I make it full subspace? Well, I look at full subspace B, let's say. I look at PV, which I literally mean the set of P after where V is in B. B exists of maps from I to H. I can pulse compose them with map from P to P. I still get a map from I to H. And you can prove that this is well defined by ejection. So these three things are the same. Okay, so check. Let's move here. Now I have to tell you what it means to be an orthomodular space. So this is a thing that's something like a Hilbert space, but maybe not quite. And that means on my crease here, so some permission space is orthomodular. Definition means, and then we have a closed subspace in this sense. Then the thing decomposes as a direct sum, like honest direct sum of Hermitian spaces now of the closed subspace and its complement. You might think this is obvious, but there do exist weird examples of Hermitian spaces where this is not right. And you can prove, and I won't do that now, that this vector space we're talking about is in fact orthomodular. Most of these proofs just use these kinds of universal properties to do that job. All right, it leaves us with one final job. We have to prove that there's an infinite orthogonal set. So far, this object H, I've just chosen at random. I grabbed it out of the bag of stuff that was given to me. Now I'm going to fix H to be some special objects. So one thing I can do is I take the tensor unit, I sum on another copy of the tensor unit, and I do that n times. Fine object always exists because we have byproducts. If you look at sort of the vector space CIH for this specific standard object H, I claim as an orthogonal set of size n. So we've got to think about this as c to the power n. Of course, it's going to have an infinite orthogonal set. What is it going to be? So I need to provide you n different maps from I into this object that are all orthogonal. I can just inject I into the first summand, I can inject it into the second, etc. And by definition, they're going to be orthogonal, and there's n different ones. That's good. Now, if I use my colimit axiom, because again, I haven't used anything infinite yet. This is where that one's going to come in. I can build not just Cn, I can build something like L2. It's the colimit of all these things. Hn maybe. Then you can do the same trick. Now I can inject into the first, into the second, into the third. Keep going, so I'll get a countable, at least, orthogonal set. So infinite is what I'm after. Infinite set. Right, just this thing. Now I apply my magic theorem. And it says, first of all, the scalars are fields or complexes, which is what we wanted, that I think you were asking. And second of all, this special object here is not just, sorry, if I pick this special object, then this is not just a vector space, but an honest to goodness Hilbert space. From that, with some massaging, you could derive that any object whatsoever is not just a vector space, but an honest to goodness Hilbert space. And with some more work, what I've shown now is you give me the mystery category. I build a functor from here to there that sort of takes its vectors, if you like. You have to prove that it's a functor. That's easy. You have to prove that it's essentially surjective. It's easy. All Hilbert spaces are isomorphic to one of this form if I take the diagram big enough. they're all isomorphic to L2 of something. I have to prove that it's full and faithful, so that maps here are one-to-one corresponds with maps there. There's some doing, but not difficult. So this is really the heart of the proof. And in the last 5 or 10 minutes, telling you about what happens if we want to talk about Hilbert modules instead of Hilbert spaces. A wipe some space. And really the only thing that's going to change, all the axioms are going to stay the same, except I'm going to drop simplicity of the tensor unit. That's the thing that said, you know, the tensor unit is sort of like the one-dimensional space. So we put a big red thing through here. Let's drop this from now on. What happens if I is not simple? Well, let's start with an easy case. Let's suppose that I is a direct sum, an orthogonal direct sum of two subspaces. Then you can prove, just with algebra like tensor products and things, that L tensor L is L, R tensor R is R, L tensor R is zero, L is zero. And from that, it follows that the whole category is, in fact, a product of two categories, where this one is I take all the morphisms, I only take the objects of the form L tensor H. Same for R. We can really split the thing apart. As soon as the tensor unit splits apart, the whole category splits apart. From that, you can prove that, I guess that's a theorem or a proposition, if C satisfies 1 to 6, except not simple. So let me say 1 to 6 time, maybe, and is semi-simple. By which I mean the tensor unit is a direct sum of finitely many copies of simple objects. Then C is equivalent not to Hilbert, but to Hilbert to the power n. So n copies of Hilbert spaces objects and n copies of maps only independent of maps. That's nice, but that's not enough. We want more. Second, relatively easy thing you can do is you can prove that, look at the projections on the tensor unit, one of these three things. It's always a complete Boolean algebra. So from that, it immediately follows that this is like a corollary. If that complete Boolean algebra happens to be atomic, then it's sort of a generalization of this, then C embeds into the product of many copies of Hilbert, where there's one copy for each atom in that Boolean algebra.
That product is the product in the category of categories?
Yes, that's right. So objects in this thing are A Hilbert space for each P, and morphisms are A map of the right type for each P. And for different P, they don't have anything to do with each other.
Is Podger I?
This, all the morphisms from I to I that are projections. Right. And the last thing I want to show you, I'm going to take 5 minutes to do that. I'm going to use another theorem that I'm not going to explain. We'll have to set up first. You have any monoidal category interested in maps into the tensor unit. I'm going to call them a subunit. And this here map is an isomorphism. The funny thing you can do. Why would I do that? If you're in a category of sheaves over some topological space, the subunits are exactly the open subsets. They correspond to open subsets of U, which is nice. If you're in a category of open modules over C naught of some compact Hausdorff space, same thing happens. So this is some tensor categorical way of recognizing the opens of the base space, if you like. And for another example, if you have all the axioms I'm talking about, then there's a map from the projections on I to, let's call this the subunits of I. That takes a projection that we know is always of the form projection on some symmetric subspace. Just takes that kernel. Factorization thing again. That's nice. The magic theorem I'm going to use here, but not explain, is about these sort of sheaf P setups. It says any monoidal category C always equivalent to the global sections of some sheaf over the space of its subunits, values in monoidal categories. So that's a bit of a mouthful. So any monoidal category, any tensor category with a tensor product like there, is always equal to the global sections of a category of sheaves, its subunits, valued in sets. So the local sections are not sets, but the local sections are monoidal categories again. So some sort of decomposition theorem. Well, if I apply this theorem to what I've learned here, these examples of Hilbert modules, you find theorem two. Oh, sorry, let me first do an example. If you look at the monoidal category of Hilbert modules over C naught X, then all the local sections are actually, all the stalks are actually all the spaces. It's just a straight application of this theorem. So, and that sort of generalizes work by Takahashi at the Hilbert module. Same thing as this is sometimes called a continuous field of Hilbert spaces. It's the same thing as a Hilbert space inside the block bottom sheaved over X. So now I can state theorem two. If you give me a mystery category satisfying 1 to 6, but maybe not simple, and it so happens that the subunits of the tensor unit form a zero dimensional space. Something, there's some space you can always extract. You can just ask for the zero dimensional. Then
is equivalent to Happy of Hilbert modules over C not X.
Recognize categories of Hilbert modules as well.
Let's say find a bit more. This means that every open thing is open. Perhaps you can derive that every subunit dominates, it lies above, is bigger in the partial order, a kernel. This assumption helps you connect where did they go? Theorem one, they talk about kernels. This theorem where you talk about subunits. Use this to decompose things into stalks of Hilbert spaces and sort of reconstruct the whole thing. And I'm going to stop there. Thank you very much.